Hello.
Hi, how you doing?
Good. How are you, everybody?
Hi, Emily.
Hey,
Good.
Emily.
Hello, Emily.
Hello. There we go.
Hi, Fred.
Hello. Oh, hey, how are you?
Nice seeing you again. Hi, nice seeing everybody. I'm printing something. I'll be right back.
Hey Dan, what's your background?
My background is camel's hump.
I thought so. I thought so. My sister lives up in Vermont. I actually had a place that overlooked Camel's Hump at one point.
Nice, nice. And my daughter took this picture last summer at sunrise.
Everybody.
Hello, Margot.
Margot.
Do we have someone who would be able to take notes tonight?
I should be able to take notes for you.
Oh, great. Thank you. Hello, Susie.
Good evening.
Well, it looks like we're all here. Margot and Chris, do you mind changing your name from EST number? Member? And it's 7:02, and we can get started. In keeping with the ongoing emergency order from Governor Charlie Baker to limit gatherings and maximize social distancing, this meeting will be conducted remotely over Zoom and broadcast live on Bedford Cable Access Television. This meeting will be to use Zoom, you will need to download the Zoom application and create an account or use one of the call-in numbers listed on the agenda. You will need the meeting ID to join by phone only. To be recognized, please use the raised hand function found under participants from Zoom or make a request via chat. If you are joining only by phone, you can press star 9 to raise your hand. If an applicant wishes to be seen during testimony or display materials, please make the request of the chair and the meeting host will enable your video. And we will do a roll call attendance starting in my upper left Zoom box with Bob.
Yep, present.
Chris. Oh, Chris, you're on mute.
Present.
Dan?
Present.
Margot?
Present.
Susie?
Here.
And I'm present. Everyone is present tonight. The first item on our agenda is the topic of hiring a sustainability coordinator. And we are very fortunate to have Fred Kenny.
Sorry to interrupt. Can we just agree? I think it's my terms for minutes. Has anyone else started minutes already?
If you want to do them, that's fine. I'd start them, but.
Well, what if you started them? What, you can have them. Just want to make sure we're clear.
That was nice of you.
So tonight we have Fred Cunningham joining us from Shoreborne to share his experience with the process of getting a sustainability director in his town. To give you a little bit of background about Mr. Cunningham, he began his career as an educator by teaching English and social studies for grades 7 through 9. After 10 years of teaching, Fred switched to business where he built multimedia educational tools and later developed and taught the Management Development Program and Leadership Academy. He also taught individual skills such as presentation, consulting, and negotiation. Fred's interest in climate issues began in the early 1970s when he focused on leading a 3-year oceanography project at his school on Buzzards Bay. He became a scuba diver and has witnessed the deterioration of our nearshore ecological systems, especially the impact on coral reef systems. Recognizing that what we do on land directly affects the oceans, Fred turned his attention to local climate action. He is a founding member of Upper Charles Climate Action, which led the successful campaign to hire sustainability coordinators in Holliston and Shoreborne. Fred is currently a member of the Shoreborne Energy Committee and lives in town with his wife, Joanne. They have 2 daughters and 3 grandchildren and 1 big 90-pound dog. And with that, I will turn it over to Mr. Cunningham. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Well, thank you all for having me. And this is, you know, when we talk about this whole thing of campaigns like this, it's really the allies that you create and utilize that make it really easy. I mean, that's what we did. And I'm really happy that you reached out to us because, you know, why reinvent the wheel if something we have is useful to you? I thought what I might do is start with a little background on our campaign, kind of culminating with our lessons learned, and then open it up to questions. So if I can, do I have share capability at the moment?
Let me make you a host.
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you, Tisha.
You should be all set, Fred.
Okay, thank you, that's great. Now if I can find what I'm looking for. Yeah, there we are. Okay, and I'm gonna fire that up. Presentation mode, hopefully. Yep, good, we're getting there. Okay, so are you all just seeing the Sherman coordinator blue screen now, or are other things up? Just that, good. Because I'd like to keep a note secret, you know? not true. So yeah, again, my name's Fred Cunningham. Emily and Christine asked me to talk to you about our campaign in Sherburn and Holliston. Our local climate action group, Upper Charles Climate Action, identified the need and then led the campaign for citizens to vote at it in town meeting. What form of town meeting do you have? Is it representative or direct?
Open.
Sorry?
Open/direct.
Okay, great. That's the same way we were, and therefore we knew we had to convince a whole lot of people in town to vote for this rather than just, you know, a few town officials. Okay, so let me run very quickly through why me. I, as Emily very nicely said in the intro, you know, I became deeply involved in this because I was involved in advanced biology, oceanography, teaching, and mostly because I became a scuba diver in the late 1980s. And I've literally had, I'll call it the opportunity, it's not really that, but the opportunity to see the destruction of coral reefs over time. And these nearshore reefs, to me, are, they're the canary in the coal mine. And that's what brought me back to land to say what we're doing on land is increasing ocean temperature. It's acidifying near shore. We're polluting, like I was diving off of Bermuda, 80% coral kill because of the temperature and because of the number of boat traffics over the shallows. So it's something that, you know, I finally realized that I had to become actively involved or else I was really just part of the problem if I wasn't part of the solution. So moving on. Upper Charles Climate Action is our local citizens group. And we're focused on both government, but also local activities. And I lead the education sub-team and local sub-team for UCCA. So this project, however, involved the entire UCCA group. It was a large project, took us, if you go from date of launch to date of hire, 2 years, and a lot of activity in there. So 4 years ago, a number of us in Sherbourne decided, hey, you know, we should put together a citizens group to influence the town's decisions around sustainability, emissions, what individuals could do for carbon footprints, et cetera. And we just put it out there and few people responded. From that small start, we very quickly realized that no matter what we tried to do, there were too few of us to have a large impact and that we should ally with other groups. So Sherbourne, Holliston, and Ashland all had small groups. We got together, called ourselves Upper Charles Climate Action, affiliated ourselves with 350 Massachusetts, and later were joined by Dover. One of the first things we did was just reach out to like-minded organizations. Metro West has a huge number of nodes or groups. 350 Mass has a whole set of coordinators around Massachusetts and the country, really, but Massachusetts for sure. So there were a lot of people that we could connect and start to realize, you know, what have other people done? What have other towns done? What have other organizations done? That's kind of the background of it. And this is how we came to the coordinator campaign. There were, I think, 19 of us in UCCA at that time, and we wanted to do things. But the question was, what needs to be done? And so we partnered with Metro West to get their checklist of 57 actions that towns could take to reduce their carbon footprint. And then what we did with that, and this is the important part, and this is really part of the campaign, is we went and talked to town officials, influencers in town, DPW, wherever somebody might have information about what of these 57 things have we done, what's in the planning mode, and what's not even on the radar. Then we connected with other towns and environmental groups to find out, you know, how had they addressed some of these issues that arose. The thing that led us to a coordinator campaign was this, that when we finally, you know, kind of finished the 57 action checklist with the town, we found that there were 15 very high priority items that really should be worked on quickly, right? And then there were a bunch of secondary items that also should be worked on. So as we like to say in New England, light dawned on Marblehead that we just could not do this alone. We needed to do something else. So once again, and this is going to be a continuing theme through this, is research. We went back out to towns in the area and said, how have you dealt with these massive lists of stuff that needs to be done? What worked for you, what didn't work for you? And what became clear very quickly, we talked to probably 15 towns, I think, I can't remember. What became clear quickly was that the towns that had an energy manager, sustainability coordinator, sustainability manager, whatever you want to call them, those were the ones that made real progress. And that makes sense. They were dedicated resources whose sole focus was climate, emissions, town, local residents, and businesses. So it became very clear to us that that's where we had to go. And that's what that's the background history of how we got to a sustainability coordinator campaign. And later I'd love to hear why you folks decided you needed one. But this is where really the rubber meets the road, because we really needed to get into action. And the first thing we realized was, and the reason I asked about your town meeting structure is we were going to have to put together a town meeting article and direct the town to hire a coordinator, which meant we needed enough people voting for it to make that happen. So we identified what were the key arguments that we could use to influence voters. And again, more research. Obviously, we by this point, we had connections with a lot of towns, with a lot of coordinators, with a number of town officials in other towns. And so we just reached out once again and said, okay, we're gonna have this campaign. What did you do? How did it work? And we brainstormed and all that stuff as you would expect. And then we engaged. And this is really the heart of the matter. You can talk all day about doing something, but if you're just talking, that's nothing. You have to act. So we organized, and we found this to be really critical. We organized all of our actions into what's the action, who owns that action, even if they're the leader of the team or they might be doing it individually, and what was the due date. And that action item list just got built as we found new actions we needed to be doing. The one thing I'd say about that is when an action's complete, don't take it off the list. And you'll see why a little later. But never take any action off the list, just mark it complete, put a green whatever near it, whatever. And so over time, you get to see what have we done and completed, what's still in process, and now what are we seeing we need to do that we're assigning. But I've always found in my entire career that if I have an action item list, never take anything off it. The ones completed sink to the bottom, but they're there as evidence of what we've done. We took action by very early on engaging town officials and boards. And this was critical. The one thing we didn't want to do was show up like demanding something with the town officials having no idea we were coming. So we sat down with, for instance, the town administrator and said, okay, if we were to have a coordinator, how would you fund that? What would be the reporting relationship? And we had influence in that because we sort of knew what the funding should be and we knew what the reporting relationship should be. But the biggest thing was we met with towns and boards before going public. We also met with committees like the Council of Aging or a group called Save Our Sherburn, which is a group of influential people. So any town group that would meet with us, we met with. And we talked over the idea. We didn't even have, you know, presentations per se at that point, just to get an idea of where's the where are the arguments that are working, where's the opposition and why do they think this shouldn't happen, and all of that stuff. It is another little important thing that we found, and this is just one example of it, but small acts really add up. So we had a small group, a sub team that was in charge of just finding people who were willing to put up lawn signs. Now in Sherburn alone, I think we had a target of 40 lawn signs 3 weeks before the vote, making sure that they were up around town 3 weeks. We had 46 3 weeks before the vote, so we beat that and we all got the cheer. But it really made a difference because many people in town are not gonna, they're not gonna come and be on your core action team. They're not gonna do hours and hours of work. But they will put up a lawn sign, and when their neighbor says, what's that about, they'll talk to them about it because they'll be informed, hopefully. Hopefully they don't just put up a lawn sign and have no idea what they're doing, right? So that was another important thing that we did, and throughout there were small actions that allowed us to understand who's with us, even if they're not gonna, you know, spend 5 hours a week doing this kind of stuff. We also then, of course, educated the public through a number of presentations. But also the big thing we did, which I strongly recommend is a great thing to do, is we brought in 4 coordinators from the Massachusetts area, one from Arlington, Ken Pruitt, one from Concord, Kate Hanley, one from Melrose, Martha Groner, and one from Natick, Jillian Wilson-Martin. And they sat down, now this was pre-COVID, so we actually had people in the room, believe it or not, if you can remember that. But I think we had like 53 or 4 people in the room, and they spent, it was about a 2-hour panel talking about what coordinators do, what's the ROI, and that, I mean, you already know that you're going to run into how much is this going to cost and what do we get back for the effort. So be prepared for ROI questions. And I sent a presentation to Emily earlier that I think she distributed to you, that has a lot of that kind of information in it, the stuff we actually used when we were in front of groups trying to convince them. It happens to be the presentation from the coordinator night, but it's the same information in most of our presentations. So that came off really well, and we also got it recorded for TV so that people who weren't there that night could see it whenever they wanted to. All the things you'd expect, media outreach groups for social media, newspapers, et cetera. We formed good relationships with the newspapers, which was great because they love to have the content and they would post it for us very quickly. One of the interesting things we had to do, and I don't think you do have to because you are you, but we're in Sherburne specifically, the town's energy committee hadn't met in 3 years, which tells you how strong the focus was. but they hadn't met in 3 years. So we actually, UCCA actually kind of went out, talked to a number of the people in the energy committee, said, are you willing to make this happen again? Let's get this going. Because what we knew was we needed insider support. Once the town voted during town meeting for a coordinator, UCCA wasn't going to be driving the business anymore. It was going to go over to the town, to the energy committee and the town administrator to make it happen. So we know we needed the energy committee to be active so that we could, frankly, put someone on it, me, and ensure that the intent of the town vote was maintained. So we got there. Town meeting passed the vote, 123 yes to 2 no. So it was celebration time. We had a good potluck dinner and sat around and congratulated ourselves. One of the things though that happened, you know, celebration shouldn't happen just at the end. One of the reasons that I like the action item list idea is you can go back and say, look at what we've done. Huh, that's interesting. We're doing all this stuff and we got all this stuff to do. But it's the little steps along the way. You want to keep your eyes on the finish line, but you also want to notice where your feet are landing every day, getting to that finish line. And that keeps people engaged as well. We had a couple of people on the team at some points who were saying, I don't know really what's going on and how to contribute. And if we hadn't been able to help them understand how to contribute, they would have drifted off. We actually had one member that did drift off during this time, not specifically because of this campaign, but just simply because she felt she didn't know what to do. But, and this is the important part, it ain't over yet. One of the things that UCCA did was kept monitoring the town's actions to ensure that the citizens' intent in the vote was followed. And that actually came up in one meeting, and we knew it was going to come up this way. In one meeting, someone with a lot of influence wanted to simply hire the person they liked and call it a day. No interviews, no looking for other candidates, nothing like that. So we knew that was coming up in a select board meeting. We actually went to every select board meeting, but we knew that was coming up and we stocked the room full of about 10 UCCAers. And when that person said, well, let's just hire this person, I've got it done. We all stood up and said, nope, not gonna happen that way. That's not the intent. So we, and there were a number of little times over the course of hiring that we needed to intervene a bit or at least represent the citizens' vote. I joined, UCCA member, joined the Energy Committee because that's where the coordinator job was going to be fully defined, where we're going to identify the candidates, interview the candidates, and make a recommendation to the select board. So again, rather than have UCCA completely out of the picture, we stacked the deck a little bit, I guess you could say. And for us, now the real action begins, right? I mean, all that 2 year work was simply to get a coordinator in place. It was actually a year and a half and then another half year of negotiation to get the coordinator in place. And then is when the real action begins. So UCCA members are deeply involved both in Holliston and in Sherburne, both were successful campaigns, are deeply involved to this day with multiple projects with our coordinators. I'm on 3 distinct projects with the coordinator and many of my other colleagues in the UCCA are on other pieces of what the coordinator is trying to achieve. Again, because, you know, okay, the coordinator is dedicated and all that, but they still need help. They can't do it all alone by any means. So I thought this might be the most useful part. It's just to briefly go through what did we learn as a group about making this campaign work. And number one, find allies. You want to find groups, towns, anybody, and beg, borrow, steal, well, don't steal, beg, borrow documents and presentations. And one of the things that I really saw was every time we connected with a town or a coordinator or some other group, they had assets because we were connecting with groups that had done this campaign. They had assets and they were just, here, take this. This is here, take this presentation. Here's a spreadsheet of all the actions you need to do. Da, 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 da. You probably already have found this, but it's the network of climate action groups around Massachusetts are not only very active, but they're very open for sharing and everything else. And actually, I was at a coordinator meeting a year and a half ago before COVID with all the coordinators from Massachusetts. And I was amazed. Coordinators were walking up to other coordinators and saying, hey, Bob, do you know about this grant? You should go for it. Well, they're saying, compete with me, right? But it was just sharing. Everybody is quite happy to share this. Lesson number two, do your homework, which really means, you know, looking at other towns and what they've done, other groups, what they've done, but also for yourself. You need to become individually ready to influence others. And that means dedicating time. A lot of time for me anyway, reading reports like the governmental Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report, hunting websites for compelling data, talking to 350 Mass, whatever. It's just a question of, if I'm going to convince somebody, especially somebody who has reservations or misconceptions, I'd better know my stuff because they're gonna look to me for answers. And that's just the way it is. You gotta put the time in to be able to really have a compelling argument, right? And you need to structure your argument to make sure that that it creates a coherent narrative for people so that they can come from ignorance about an issue to focus on it. And that really means understanding what your audience cares about, which goes back to talking to everybody you can talk to on the planet, and listen to their concerns. And one of the things that I found, which shouldn't have startled me, but it did, was that people really came up with incredible misunderstandings. They'd come to a presentation, they'd hear four words in a whole, you know, half hour and walk away with a misconception. So we had to watch for those, listen for those, and then fix them. And there were a fair number of misconceptions. Another thing, know your key players and listen to them. Right? So we were listening to people's concerns and misunderstandings. But the ones that we really needed to listen to were those kind of key players, the town administrator, the select board, the advisory or financial board, town committees, DPW, facilities, all those people. We needed to listen to them because they're the people I didn't want to surprise. Like I was talking to DPW, our head of DPW, and he said, yeah, well, you get a coordinator and they come up with all these great things to do. Guess who has to do them, right? That was a valid concern, right? You know, any facility that the coordinator, you know, we're looking at four or five buildings, DPW is going to be the ones that have to kind of run that show. So we needed Sean on our side early, and as well as the town administrator, all the others. So the idea is not to surprise anybody with your efforts. Anybody who can say yes, or has the power to say yes, or is an influencer who could say no, you need to engage them early before you go public. I think it's the next thing. Yeah, engage them early. and then, you know, as I said before, action item lists with clear actions, clearly who's responsible for them and what is the due date. Obviously, you know, once you're in the program, you need to execute. You need to do what you say you're gonna do. The next two are a little different in that they're not just straight actions like talking to a town administrator. But to celebrate along the way, as I kind of pointed to a minute before, small victories keep the group organized and keep them engaged. Right? And then another one that was really important is relax. You know, this kind of campaign is a marathon. There are small sprints within it, but you gotta know when to push, when to relax, and when to just sit back and enjoy the show that's going on around you. And like I said before, you want to keep your eyes on the finish line, but watch your steps to get there, because you don't want to trip on the way. So I'm going to end this way, because I ran into this time and time again. People saying, look, I get it, but it doesn't matter what I do. It's just one drop in the bucket. Makes no difference. Okay, you say I should insulate my home. So what? Right? I'm not, you know, why should I spend that money? My response to that is this. Your efforts might feel like just a drop in a bucket, but with enough drops, find out you got a full bucket. And that kind of resonated with all of us that, yeah, you know, okay, so I did a mass save energy audit and I had some things done. What big deal is that? Well, if everybody in town did that, it would be a big deal. Right? Okay, you know, I might buy an EV car, but so what? Well, if many more people in town bought EV cars, it would make a difference. Those kind, and we actually get charging stations and all of that because of the demand. So I'm going to leave it there. That's longer than I intended to talk, but I tend to talk too much. So any questions, thoughts, concerns, and I'll stop sharing. There we go. So how can I help you all?
That was a great presentation, Fred. Really some great things in there. Some that I think we've thought about and some that we definitely need to think more about, even aside from having a sustainability coordinator. That's a great plan for action that you put together.
Yeah, it's just, it's essentially a grassroots action plan. Doesn't really matter what the campaign is.
Emily, there are a couple of questions for Fred in the, can you access them?
Thank you.
Do you want me read them?
I just found them actually.
From Renew, yeah.
Yep, actually, yeah. What specific projects and benefits has the coordinator position in Sherbourne brought to the town? Are there any financial benefits, you know, that you can quantify for us?
Yeah, interesting question in the year of COVID. One of the research things we found, and it's in the presentation I gave to Emily, is that we contacted, well, we used Neil Duffy's capstone project, which was to look at four cities in Massachusetts and calculate the return on investment for a coordinator. And then we talked to, I believe it was 15 other towns, and gathered what they had done. So I'm sorry, I lost it, Fred, because I got all excited about that. What was the question again?
Just what specific projects and benefits has the project, coordinator right. brought to the town?
And the ROI. That's what gets me every time is the ROI. I go off on the tangent. There are a number of projects the fact of the matter is we have two coordinators. We have a halftime sustainability coordinator, and the town planner has been given, I think, 12 hours a week to work on grants and other sustainability stuff. So we've got a couple of grants, one to look at a geothermal system for one of our schools, another grant to upgrade three buildings to consult around upgrading three buildings. We don't have the money to actually upgrade them yet, but if we have a good plan, then we could put that into MAPC or another green communities type thing. We are a green community. We are doing a number of actions in the schools, curricular actions, working with the task force from the school, which is students and teachers. We have community aggregation starting, which I know you have already been through, so you know big projects. And we are working with just starting in Sherbourne alone right now, but we intend to expand it quite a bit more widely, a coaching cadre, which would simply be, you know, I get the mass save thing and I understand my house and I've done the right insulation stuff. Now I want to put on heat pumps or I want to put on solar or I want to find out about those things. I don't know what to do. Right? I've got all this data on my house, but I don't know what to do. So what the coaches are being trained to do, and we're just finishing our first cadre of training at the moment, is to engage with homeowners, get the data from the homeowners, run it through our models, and go back to the homeowner and say, look, you think you need solar panels, but if you look at the insulation in your house, you're throwing heat out of your house day after day after day. Why put on solar panels until you take care of the basics? Or whatever. Help them work through, okay, we've got four contractors for heat pumps. How do I know I'm not getting ripped off? How do I know these things are sized appropriately? What is a heat pump anyway? Why do I need it? Or do I have to keep my furnace? All those things, right? So we have that as another major effort. And I've probably forgotten a few. Streetlights. We're converting streetlights to LED. And we have a number of grants out there. The biggest thing we've found is we're very small. We're 4,200 person town. And if we don't hook up with other towns for these grants, we don't get them. You know, they look at Sherwin and say, 4,000 people, I could give the money to Sherwin, or Framingham at 30,000 people. But we'll give it to Framingham. It's going to have a bigger effect. So we're actually in a collaboration with 15 other towns right now in the Charles River watershed to get some grants to work on watershed mitigation, because we know things are going to get predictably worse in the next few years. And we have some flooding issues and tree issues and wetlands and all kinds of stuff. So the ROI we found was, if you take salary and benefits together, coordinators are returning to the town 4.2 to 8.3 times the cost to the town of the coordinator position. Now, is that guaranteed? No, of course not. But every town we talked to that had coordinators, the worst was 4.3. The best was 11.9, but we kind of discounted that. It was way out there. It was an outlier. So we stopped at 8.3 on the top. But that's compelling. Other things that we did that were compelling were, you can go to Berkeley Cool Climate and find out what your town, I'll just put this up because it's worth looking at. So I'll share it just for a moment again. Let me put this up and zip through real quickly. This is the presentation that I sent to Emily. There we go. Okay, so I'm just gonna zip through it. Whoops, yeah. So what does the coordinator do? But here's what we came up with, that, you know, the low to mid-range salary for a halftime, and we were looking at a halftime position, was 30,000, benefits loading, 9,000, total compensation, 39,000. But through grants and incentives, we had a high-end return of 8.3. So that means for the 39,000 I spent, I'm getting back 323,700. Or at the low end, 4.2, even though I spent 39,000, I'm getting back 163,800. Now, I'll tell you, COVID's put a little bit of a bump in that, because it's hard to necessarily function that easily in this world. But we have, in the 8 months since we've had a coordinator, I think we've pulled in somewhere around $300,000. I don't know the exact number, but it's up there, even in the times of COVID. So we're hoping for an 8.3 or 11.9% return. This is the stuff that we found really compelling. This is from Cool Climate at Berkeley EDU. And you can see in each town, what is the carbon impact? And the US average is 48.5, and Sherwin was running at 80.8. Now that's after becoming a cool community and after reducing via the cool community's requirement, reducing our output by 20%. Oh no, I'm sorry, this was pre 20% reduction. And then we looked at, okay, what was the energy use of Sherwin specifically? And you can see that in 2011, we became a cool community. In 2012, we immediately reduced down 28%. But then when you go from 2013 onward, you haven't made a lot of progress. And so that, in fact, we've lost some ground in some places. So that was a compelling argument. Look, we're one of the towns that is firing up the most carbon emissions, and we're not doing our part since 2013 to actually impact that heavily. And those two pieces of data together really kind of pushed the number of people to think about that. And I think that's probably the last one I want to show there. Yeah. And there are other things, but we won't bother with those. Other questions?
Yeah, what were some of the misconceptions that people raised?
The biggest one, and I can't say how many times I had to tell people, nope, not that. People were saying they will pay for themselves, which to many people meant they will find money for their own salary, which is not the case. So that was the biggest misconception. And time again, I had to say, no, they will bring more money into town from their activities than the town will spend on their salary. That's the way it is, you know. Other misconceptions. I mean, there were silly ones like, oh, we need a coordinator to tell us we have to, now we're going to have to all plant dandelions to be, you know, in our lawn, or they're going to make me rip up my driveway because it's not permeable to water. You know, silly stuff like that. Other things, misconceptions about how this could be funded. Misconceptions about what would the person be doing? You know, would they, some people thought they're just there for the municipality, just for the town. And we had to correct that because one of the major things that our coordinator is doing is outreach to citizens. We have a very small business base here. We've reached out to the businesses, but there are so few of them in town, it's kind of ridiculous. But you know, one of the, okay, so another thing, Emily, that our coordinator did was created a greenhouse gas inventory. Have you all done that yet? Yeah, okay. The greenhouse gas inventory really laid out very clearly where our problems are. 43% of our emissions come from transportation because we're a small isolated town, rural town, well, semi-rural town. And, you know, there's not a lot of public transport anywhere in town. Now, if you get to Natick, yes, you can jump on the train into Boston. But basically, you have to drive around to do everything. That was 43%. 42%, an additional 42%, came from heating and cooling and electrifying our homes. So you put that together, that's a pretty compelling argument for working with residents, because the majority of our emissions are coming from residents, not from the town itself. That answer that question?
Yeah, that was very helpful. Thank you. And I know that it sounds like the Sherborne coordinator has only been in the role for about 8 months, you said?
Yeah, she we finally hired her April of last year, which pandemic time. and a lot of that, so it was a year and a half of UCCA campaign to get to the town vote. The other 6 months were really negotiating with the town to keep the intent of that vote in place and to actually do the person who wanted to sort of shoe in their person was able to stall the entire process for 3 months. And then the next 3 months were about actually getting a coordinator, hiring her, and getting her working.
And I think you may have touched on this a bit, but who prioritizes which projects to work on first? Is it something that you do with the through the committee, or you know, with the town administrator?
One of the things that we is a more complex answer. It should be a simple answer. It's not. One of the things that that we found when we were talking to other towns was they very strongly suggested that you not have your coordinator hooked to a specific department, facilities, for instance, but that you hook them to report to the town administrator, because the town administrator has a wider scope of a wider portfolio to pay attention to. So it was constructed that they would report to the town administrator, but that our energy committee, you folks, would have general supervision. And we're still trying, now that's why it's complex. We're still trying to figure out what's general supervision mean when the town administrator is the actual boss. But the town administrator is doing so many other things that we have in fact worked with the coordinators, helped them understand what priorities are. And we're still doing that because, you know, our coordinator came in with a very strong outreach capability and a very strong focus on schools because she came from Wesley College. But we also need to expand to many other things in town that she needs to be paying attention to, which she's doing. But it was mostly the energy committee that was helping her and Gino, the town planner, understand what grants should we go after, what are the projects that could be done in town, how could citizens group help and be involved, stuff like that.
And Bedford's fortunate because we have a net zero plan that was done about a year and a half ago. So it gives, you know, a really high level framework for top priorities to reduce building carbon emissions.
Perfect. That's very helpful because we had some part of our town plan had mention of sustainability, but mostly in housing. And mm-hmm. and so we will very soon start a net zero plan for our town as well. We just haven't got there yet.
There's another question in the chat. I don't know if you're able to answer this, but how do you see the grant landscape changing over the next 5 years? Do you expect there to be more or less grant funding available?
I have to ask our state legislators about that. it's shifting. So for instance, in the last year, there's a real focus on EVs, electric vehicles, right? And charging stations and grants and subsidies and all that stuff. There's much more focus now on heat pumps because they tend to be more effective and efficient than certainly than an oil furnace. And our town is like 99% oil based furnaces. There's a few gas lines, but nothing big. I guess that's basically it. what else in that domain?
Any other questions?
Emily, a quick one, Fred. I'm curious how you ended up deciding to have 12 hours of the planner in town helping the energy coordinator. Was it because they're a better writer for grants, or did you find that you actually had more to do than a half-time job?
Supposedly we don't have more to do than a half-time job, but we do. I mean, this could be full-time. The town planner was the person that the other person wanted to shoehorn in. So it became a negotiation between someone who was very powerful in town who wanted the town planner to do the sustainability work and us saying, adding 10 hours isn't sufficient. It's not gonna work. If you're dedicated to this idea and the town is, 123 people said yes and only two said no in the town meeting, then you need to do it right. The town planner is better at grant writing. There's no doubt about it. So let's just keep him on as a grant writer. He's also very smart and environmentally focused. He was really heavily working in environment in New Orleans, where he comes from. He could have actually been the coordinator, except he's a town planner, and we just didn't see how he could keep that kind of time. Also, they're different skill sets. His skill set is government grants, working with government agencies. Hers is outreach, people connection, and working on other stuff like composting and all that. All those other things that our town planner certainly could do if he had the time, but he wouldn't have had the time. So it was a compromise, let's put it that way.
Thank you.
And that's certainly been illustrated in Bedford too. I mean, we have Taysir and Ron in the facilities department, and then also DPW working, you know, around the clock and doing a lot of, you know, finding a lot of grants and doing things to really promote sustainability. But of course, that's on top of their other full-time job right. and everything. So there's definitely a need here.
And I think that's one of the compelling arguments is, yeah, we're dedicated to doing this, but we don't have, you know, I'm running facilities or I'm running the town IT or I'm running whatever I'm running. I'll give you a couple hours a week. Not sufficient, not to really get the job done, at least in my opinion.
That's right. Any other questions for Ron, or for Fred?
We could ask Ron too.
I have a question, Emily, and maybe this is directed more towards you, but also Fred, you can chime in. I appreciated that you sent that other PowerPoint that I think is really kind of the meat and the potatoes of the of how to articulate what a sustainability coordinator is, what's the work they do, that you share the slide about the return on investment. So I guess the question is, you laid out kind of a strategic roadmap to how you guys were successful in making the argument for your community. And it seems as though that presentation, the slide deck that you sent, is a very critical piece of it. And I appreciate having it, but I almost wonder who will be the Bedford version of that? Or are those folks that we can come and have us, you know, do that presentation live for us? Or how do we customize that information to make it compelling for our situation, which of course is different than Sherburne's?
Of course, they all are. So one answer to that is simply take everything you can steal from me or anybody else, look it over and say, you know, that'll work in Bedford, but this one. So out. And you have to customize for your own town, no doubt about it. And I can send Emily a couple of other presentations that have supplemental slides that are a little bit different. But that one, Margot, is the kind of meat and potatoes of what we do.
And that's actually a perfect segue into some work that Mothers Up Front and primarily Chris has been doing over the past couple months. You know, we would like to host a public forum in June and leveraging actually three of the four directors who you had in Sherburne.
They're great.
So Arlington, Natick, and Concord. And I think Chris has actually spoken to at least Ken Pruitt and Jillian about their willingness to participate in June.
They are absolutely some of the best in the area. No kidding, I've talked to them a bunch. If you've got them, you've got gold.
Wonderful. And I watched the forum that you hosted, and it was excellent. It was very compelling. So I guess the question I have for the ESC is, would we as a committee like to co-sponsor this event, you know, date to be determined, but it'd be a Zoom, ideally with Concord, Arlington, and Natick sustainability coordinators, where they can present their returns on investment and, you know, what their, you know, the big contributions they're making to their towns. And we and the public can ask questions of them as well.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. I would support co-sponsoring such a thing and getting that set up, yeah.
So I have a question. What does it mean to co-sponsor something when we're still probably not going to be meeting in large groups?
I think it would be to help promote it. So we could promote it through our webpage and, you know, throughout the town, just to, you know, have broader publicity.
Okay, let me just say, should we let Fred go, say thank you, and let him get on with his dinner?
One more thing, and thank you, Christine, for letting me off the hook. But I would say one more thing is that one of the most powerful things we did was the coordinator panel. Because it's the real people talking to the audience and getting questions, and I found that to be one of the most powerful events that we did. Yeah, we did a lot of presentations to small groups and stuff, but that was the big one. And having cable TV record it and make it available to others was also key, because we know that people accessed it afterwards because we got a click on it. I forget how many, but it was worth doing, especially because it didn't cost us anything. Okay, well, thank you all. I hope that was useful. And please continue to, you know, utilize me, UCCA, me, whatever. We have a bunch of stuff. I don't want to overpower you with junk you might not want. But if you have a question like, how did you deal with whatever, just get back in touch and I'll answer it for you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all, and good luck. Go for it.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
So getting back to my question about what does it mean to co-sponsor with Mothers Up Front in a time like this when we can't reserve the auditorium and we'd need to use Zoom? Do we ask the town to put it on, or what do we do?
Is that, I think that'd be great if the town could. Is that something that we could do, Margot, TCR?
We can certainly, I can look into it. Again, normally, as you said, if it were an in-person thing, we would meet at the library or something like that. And I don't know the parameters for a public forum such as this in virtual land, but we can certainly look into it.
Thanks. Or the read room. We've had several mother out front meetings coordinated with in the read room, I think, that we co-sponsored.
So, Emily, are you looking for a motion to, I think it's a no-brainer to co-sponsor it, and it's in our charge. We can help get wider audience, and it will end up showing up in the Bedford TV feed the YouTube channel, things like that.
Yeah, I think that'd be great. Do we have a motion to co-sponsor a public forum on hiring a sustainability director with Mothers Up Front?
So moved. So moved.
And second?
I'll second it.
Okay.
Great. Okay, so all in favor of co-sponsoring a public forum in the spring, likely June, with Mothers Out Front, topic being hire a sustainability coordinator for the town. We'll take a roll call vote, starting with Susie.
I forgot what I say. Approved? Yeah. Aye. Yay? Yes?
Aye. Yeah. Yes.
Aye. Aye. There we go. Aye.
Bob?
Aye.
Chris?
Aye.
Dan?
Aye.
Margot?
Aye.
And I, motion approved, 600.
Thank you.
So we should have more details between now and April regarding potential dates and confirming the panelists.
So it would be good if there could be dates that people on our ESC do not think are good dates for June to let me know. That would be helpful as I work towards getting speakers.
Would we be intending this to be instead of our June ESC meeting? Or in addition to it?
In addition to it.
Go ahead, first. Our meetings are usually later in the month. And we were thinking that to avoid vacations and school conflicts, that doing something earlier in the month might be better.
Yeah.
I would just look out for high school graduation.
Okay.
Maybe we can do it between high school graduation and the end of the month.
End of school.
Yeah.
And I think we had tentatively talked, I think, someone had pointed out that high school graduation was maybe the second or third of June. So we're thinking like the week of the 7th.
It's the fourth this year.
Yeah.
Yeah. And our facilities people, I'm sure, will be busy. So after the 4th.
And how busy are our influential committees at that time, like select board and planning and FinCom? Are they still meeting every other week?
Yeah, they're... It'll be after town meeting. Town meeting is the middle of May. Okay. And so we'll be on our less frequent schedule, which is good because I think we'll still be around. It's not like we take the summer off, but we won't be quite as busy as we are in the lead up to town meeting.
Okay, good. Thanks.
I think it might help if the ESC were to like send, you know, formal invitations to those committees to attend the forum.
Great idea.
What does that look like, Dan?
I just think an email to the chair of each committee, of each board. from the ESC.
Yeah, I mean, I just say, you know, like write a little memo, send it to every chair and say, please share with your committee.
Yeah.
I didn't know if you wanted something, you know, where you send an email and it opens an envelope and a flower comes out. And you say, hey,
it would be sunshine. Sunshine on a solar panel.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so if we have the details by, you know, our April meeting, that will give us a good 6 weeks to get those invitations out and invite all the stakeholders. Okay. That sounds great.
Great.
Any other questions or comments on hiring a sustainability coordinator?
Emily, if it turns out there is some sort of problem or issue using a town Zoom account, do the Mothers Out Front have one?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So that's a good backup.
Okay. Okay. Well, moving on to the next item, it's a legislative update. And many of you probably heard that between our last meeting and now, both the House and Senate have passed an amended version of the Next Generation Roadmap. And the bill is veto-proof, but Governor Baker is expected to sign it, hopefully within the next week or so. So very positive news from the State House. And moving along, we have community choice aggregation. Any updates tonight?
So John O'Rourke has reached out to Sierra and the town manager and her staff about scheduling a preparatory meeting at the end of the month, beginning of April. Is that right, Tasier? That's coming up pretty soon, like in a week. The 31st, I think, right?
Yes.
Okay. So I think at that time we'll get some better understanding of the timeline and the trajectory. Tasier, does that sound fair?
Yes. Yeah, so we just need to really, as a feedback to, he would be looking for us to tell him the percentage of the green. Do we want to stick with the basic from the state and add the 50, the 100, those are the things, feedback to give him so it can be included, because it will be, it will impact the price.
Right, when he was here last month, I thought he said that his colleague was preparing some background information, some numbers on the energy market and what some recent CCA contracts have looked like in Massachusetts. Is that something that he's provided yet, or that he's going to provide soon?
I think that's part of the meeting, Dan, that he would,
okay,
you know, give some information.
Tasier, correct me if I'm wrong, this is like a kickoff meeting. It's not, it's the preliminary. Then presumably we could bring whatever documentation he provides to the committee to review and provide some input before we finalize. Does that seem
like that
the time frame would work?
Yes. So yeah, you're right. It's just really a kickoff meeting so we can figure out some of the details.
And what sort of timing do you need? You know, say, like, do we need to have the meeting earlier in the month to get back to him, you know, with an appropriate time frame, or do we have, you know, all month to make those decisions or review the material?
Yeah, so we haven't really discussed it, but there is really no deadline. I mean, you could almost, he would like to have as much information, as much whatever he needs, so he can kind of really play the market so that he's ready in case if they see the market is moving towards an attractive rate. He may reach out to us and say, look, if we do it next month, this would be really a good time to do it because, you know, the market is just trending that way. So I think just to be ready. But otherwise, our contract is good through November, I believe, December.
It's December. It's through the final meter read on the end of December. Can we just remind everybody what the tiers are that we currently have? We have the general CCA rate, which was the plus five, and then people could opt up to 100, but was there something else that could they opt up to 50?
Yeah, they could opt up to 50 or they could opt up to 100, and they could actually opt down.
Opt down back right. to the basic, essentially.
Right.
Or the no additional
right. rate. Right.
So I don't know, I feel like there were very few people who opted to 50%, if I'm remembering that correctly. And then a sort of predictable number who opted up to 100. I thought that
right.
in the past, John had sort of expressed that the number of opt-outs were pretty typical and the number of opt-ups were pretty typical.
Right.
And Dan, when we spoke last time, you reminded us about what the net zero plan had sort of been guiding us towards in terms of, you know, I think it maybe was a slower trajectory.
Right. The net zero plan goals were 50% green energy by 2030 and then 100% green by 2050.
And I think John said that we're already at just with the renewable portfolio standard, we're at 20?
20, yeah.
So, I mean, I think that probably we would want to be doing something that would show progress on our net zero targets.
Definitely, yeah.
That'll be interesting to see what he can provide us.
Yeah, on other towns, what other towns are doing.
Right. So I'm just trying to think, we're at 2021, 22. So 2030 is 8 years away. And we, you know, obviously if we got to 50 before then that probably would be fine too, right? Obviously.
Oh yeah.
But I can't remember what the plan said, if it was supposed to be sort of stepwise, equal increments every year, or, you know, I feel like just putting some parameter, just some, like a starting parameter around it, and we can just tell John O'Rourke that as a beginning icebreaker for the conversation, kind of like maybe a something that would be acceptable, and then maybe something that might be a reach, and see what the energy markets look like.
I have a question. If we just stayed with what the state was doing, the state does 2% a year?
I think
is that what it is?
I think so, yeah. So that's the thing, to get to 50, the state portion is going to keep on going in a linear path, right? And then we're adding on top of that every year, probably a small, you could go smaller, right? Like you're always making progress, right? Like the water is always rising. The state is always lifting you up a little bit, and you have to make up the rest.
Right.
It'll be real interesting to see what he comes up with, what John comes back with.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Well, we'll look forward to that next month. Any other CCA questions or comments? Does anyone have a BARC update tonight?
I did not hear from, I wrote to Dan, but did not hear back from him about what's going on with gas leaks and the metering thing.
The one piece of information I can give you is that Amy Fidalgo was able to reach out to the Community Preservation Coalition folks, who have a lot of great, they provide assistance on kind of helping towns figure out what is and isn't in bounds for CCA stuff. And it seemed like the standalone purchase of the equipment might be something that might not generally be something that CCA funds would be used for, but we haven't had another community, we haven't had another CPA meeting, so we haven't discussed it any further at this point. But certainly not for, we're going to town meeting with a budget that does not include the gas leaks equipment right now, but we'll get clarification on that in the future.
I think what I heard last at a BARC meeting was that he missed a deadline also. There was something about missing another deadline for CPA. No? And that they were considering some other options.
Okay, I mean, I think the issue was that we had our public hearings and communication took their votes and chose not to move ahead with that, and then subsequently got this piece of guidance from the coalition. That's how I understand it anyway. But as I said, we haven't had a CPC meeting since then.
The next item is to review the ESD charge, and hopefully everyone's had a chance to take a look at it before the meeting. Does anyone have any specific comments or thoughts about the charge and any suggested modifications or points that we want to, you know, be sure we highlight and focus on over the next few months? Oh, Bob?
Yeah, I just, it was actually interesting to go through it again and to go through the various highlights. And as our friend Fred was saying, to celebrate the little victories and the accomplishments. But one thing I saw as a key element that I know we work on, and that is providing, we're talking about the Energy and Sustainability Charge, Committee Charge. Is that what we're talking about? Yeah. I was just trying to keep the order of the agenda. I wanted to make sure I wasn't talking about something you didn't want to talk about. In any case, the getting out information on the website, and I think it would be useful for all of us to go through and kind of make notes. From what I understand, Susie's the one on the committee that is in charge of telling the webmeister of the town what to do on the website or keep it up. But I think it would be useful for all the rest of us to take some ownership of it as well and go through it and see where maybe we could put some new material or make it a little less confusing if we find it confusing. And in digging through all that, the one thing I found that I didn't know whether I just didn't know where to find it was the electric and gas use. I think there's a tab on the website about how we're doing on energy consumption for the town. And I assume is it town facilities only, or is it the whole town? In any case, it seemed to show the data just through the same as the net zero report 2018. And just wondering if 2019 and 2020 might be a little hard to get a hold of right just yet, but at least 2019. So we could see trends and whatnot, and just maybe I wasn't looking in the right place for it. But that's just an example of, I think the website can be a powerful use if we, and related to that, and maybe Margot knows, I know periodically towns, private entities, everybody updates their websites. And I know town, Bedford's is due for a major update, and maybe it's a mute point until that happens, but.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you know, I think you're right that it's getting on. I remember when we switched to this and it seemed new for a while, but now we've had this system for a while. And I do believe that we have, that is something that will be in the cards, but I don't have a time frame on it, unfortunately. And I will just say, I remember when we had the net zero consultant, that he did some of the legwork to chase down the utility costs for the entire town. And that's why it got put into the report. I'm sure that we have municipal energy consumption information that Taseer, I presume you have a dashboard or something. I'm not sure whether we had been committing ourselves to providing the level of data that our consultant was able to get for the net zero plan on an ongoing rolling basis, or if what we were talking about was just continuing to share municipal utility consumption.
So we have shared that on the website. So it's under Bedford Annual Energy Report. So the 2020 annual report is out there with the town consumption by building.
Right. So I guess that's sort of an open question. Like, is there a meaningful way without being in the middle of a net zero plan where you have a consultant who's doing that legwork to continue to update that information or not?
Not for the town as a whole, I don't think. It's one of the things our net zero consultant was telling us is that the utilities are not really compelled to provide that information in a speedy and easily accessible way. So it's there, but you have to work hard to get it.
And so I mean, it's a shame when you think about the trend for adding air conditioning, the number of houses that have air conditioning now, especially with the mini splits, it's almost the fashionable thing to do to buy a mini split. So there are a lot more in town, and all the new construction, whereas 20 years ago, did not have. So as the temperature rises, it might be a depressing number that would motivate us, but maybe we're doing pretty good in the last couple of years because of all the other initiatives. I think it's worth at least thinking about how to measure it.
So for us, we do produce our really monthly reports and we put them on our own website. I think a couple of years ago, we had an idea floating that if we can just provide the town side with the link. So if someone is interested, if the person is on the energy and sustainability website and they wanted to see how the public buildings are doing, they can have just click somewhere and it would take them to us directly to the facilities website. I have to say though, the last couple of weeks, our staff, we've been testing really a nice toy by Power Options. It's a nice dashboard and it's a lot more sophisticated and more really informative than our simple, humble spreadsheet that we generate. So we're looking into it now. As soon as really, maybe the next meeting, I'll take just a few minutes to show you the sample if it's still available to us. But it's very cool. It's not just limited to the energy usage. It's, you know, the gas, the whole thing, the greenhouse gas, the carbon. It's really nice, easy to use. We were very impressed with it when we were testing it last week. So it's something we can at some point reach out to the IT department on the town side and maybe have them do that one click link to us instead of duplicating really the information everywhere.
Yeah, just having a quick hot link would be a good thing, yeah.
I'm kind of elaborating on Bob's suggestion, looking at, I guess it's bullet number 6, educate and raise awareness among Bedford residents regarding energy efficiency and greenhouse gas reduction. I think that's something I know I personally could do a better job of through social media and, you know, some of the groups I'm involved in is just promoting some of the opportunities within. And that's certainly something we'll be doing when we promote the need to hire a sustainability director. So I just think it's something that we could all just be aware of and kind of when we have those opportunities, just make sure we utilize them.
Yeah, I think that's also, you know, using the communications channels that are available as a group, you know, in addition to our individual personal messaging that we might set out, but also as a committee, some committees have written a column in the Citizen or, you know, written a letter to the editor or something like that, if there's something topical to discuss or some opportunity. I feel like we did that when there was like the Solarize program, that we sent letters to the editor or submitted a column or something like that. And that could be also something to consider doing on some sort of more regular basis, topics that need, that, you know, would benefit from being elevated to some more public notice by actually getting, you know, doing it as a group as opposed to just individually.
That's a great idea. Any other comments or suggestions?
Okay. I have one other that probably relates to a different agenda item, so I'll hold it for that.
It's okay, you're welcome to share now.
Oh no, it just had to do with, I think, is there something on the agenda about, I thought there was something you sent out, maybe it's not an agenda item, but the whole issue of BARC having a warrant article related to becoming an official part of the bylaws.
So that would be the next agenda item.
Yeah, so that's yeah.
Good. Good segue.
So I can jump in if you want, Emily.
That'd be great, Marga.
Okay. So the select board has closed the warrant, and among the items that will be up for vote at town meeting will be the inclusion of three new standing committees that are being proposed to be put into the bylaws. And that would be BARC, Energy Sustainability, and Patriotic Holiday Committees. And for folks who've been on Energy and Sustainability a long time, so maybe Susie and Dan, you'll know that we used to be a committee where we were appointed for 1 year. We were called the Energy Task Force. This committee had been created as an ad hoc committee, essentially to achieve green community status in 2009. After that first generation of Energy and Sustainability Committee, or Energy Task Force as it was called then, there was, and this would have been, oh gosh, 5 years ago, maybe, an interest in formalizing Energy and Sustainability as a standing committee. We changed the name, right? We changed the charge. And there was a presentation to the select board about the charge. Maybe Dan, maybe, I don't know if you did it.
Yeah, I did.
I don't think it was 5 years ago.
What's that?
Maybe 3 years ago.
Okay. Well, discussions about this may have started 5 years ago. And because I remember I spoke to the then town manager about kind of this netherworld, or like in between a committee that is no longer an ad hoc committee because we've decided that it's got legs, right? It's going to continue. There's still a role to play, agreement on the charge, but it was not technically a quote unquote bylaw committee, which are the way that currently that's how we distinguish between things that are permanent and things that are temporary. So there has been a lot of discussion about whether or not that's the right way to have committees, or if it's too cumbersome, you keep on adding things to the bylaws. But the decision has been made, and the select board has voted to go ahead and propose these to be added to the bylaws with the same charges that they have now. There's nothing is changing. Not the composition, not the terms, not the number of members, not the responsibilities. It is simply taking the charge, and instead of it just being in this sort of in-between world of not an ad hoc committee, but not a bylaw committee, and just putting it into the bylaws. So that is what's happening. That's what's being proposed to town meeting to happen. Does that explain things clearly?
And what are the three committees again?
Energy Sustainability, BARC, and Patriotic Holidays. And really, I mean, I think the biggest takeaway is that it doesn't give our committee any more powers or any more legitimacy than it had before. All it means is that if we want to change the charge of the committee in the future, you'll have to do it at town meeting. It won't just be going to the select board. That is essentially all it means, which, you know, you could say that might be good because it means that our charge is stable. But on the other hand, you might say, then it makes it a little harder. You can't be quite so nimble. If you wanted to change the charge, you're going to have to wait until town meeting and get town meeting to vote on it. But essentially that's it. Like there's, and so it's interesting because one of the things I was going to mention to you all is that the finance committee, which likes to review all of the warrant articles, has asked me to come to their meeting tomorrow night to talk about the inclusion of energy and sustainability in the bylaws. It doesn't have a financial implication, so I'm not 100% sure what their questions will be, but essentially I will say to them more or less exactly what I just said to you. But if you would like to come,
yes,
I think in case there are other questions that come up regarding why we might be doing this. And like I said, the discussion about doing this or someday potentially doing this goes back many years. And I really don't know any more than that about what the nature of the questions will be from the finance committee, but you guys are very welcome to come with me, be my backup band.
Can you send out, do we just get the Zoom link on FinCom?
On the town website, if you go to the agendas, just you'll get the link off of the agenda. And I don't know exactly when on their agenda. Hold on, I don't know if they put times. I don't think they put times.
Okay.
Here's their agenda. Let me just look.
Tomorrow, 3:25.
So it's immediately, it's at the beginning. They've got two, they're going to be two bylaws that I'm there, two articles that I'm talking about. And it's the second of the two, but it's the first item on their agenda.
Great. What time do they start? Do you have it there?
Seven.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. And I believe, if I remember correctly, when this whole process started would have been with the Charter and Bylaw Committee, that Emily, maybe you or Dan, I can't remember who was chair at that time, sent the Charter and Bylaw Committee a kind of approved version of our charter. We reviewed it and we sent it to them. Does that ring bells?
Yes, that happened. I think Ed Pierce was on that committee and he's the one that reached out. I believe I was the chair at the time and we all discussed it and yeah.
Right. So before town meeting, then obviously energy and sustainability might be expected to have an opinion about the Warren article. So we'd want to take a position.
And are there any other Warren articles that we should be aware of coming up?
Nothing that's under discussion by finance, nothing else under discussion by finance committee. I will say that finance committee did vote to recommend approval of the capital projects, including the police station and the library HVAC system, which had significant net zero components. That's good news. There's also an electric vehicle in the capital plan. There's actually a police cruiser that is, I think it's an EV. Taysir, maybe?
Yes.
Is it correct? Yeah. So I know that was a long standing request or hope that there would be either battery backup or EV police vehicles. So now I guess there's an outfit that is producing them that seems to, the specs seem to be all good. So that's happening. So when we get closer to annual town meeting, which is going to be the middle of May, so maybe next meeting, maybe our April meeting, it, maybe what we should just do is put the warrant for the annual meeting on the agenda. And then I can just go through and highlight any ones that you might want to consider, or we, meaning you, might want to consider taking a position on.
Oh, perfect. That sounds great. Does anyone have additional net zero updates? I know we've talked about CCA and the sustainability director, but is there anything else to discuss tonight? Moving along then, any updates on electric charging stations?
So yeah, we did apply for the grant in two different forms. One is for public use, one for really staff use. One for the public, we get more money for it. The grant gives us more percentage than if it's just strictly for the staff. But I did apply for another one just for the police when I heard they're buying an electric vehicle. I'm like, okay, if it shows up tomorrow, then what? So we did apply to install electric charging stations. And if the project is approved, the addition slash renovation, we would install them at that time anyways, regardless really. But applying to the grant would give us, you know, a step ahead to buy them and install them just in time for the electric vehicle. So we did include all the schools to have more charging stations, and the high school, the other schools, and town hall will have two more. So we're expanding them. Again, the electrical infrastructure is there to accommodate up to eight of them. When Eversource gave us the service, they can do up to 8 or 10. So we have it. So it's really just the cost of the charging station itself. And that's where the state will pick up a good percentage of it, at least 50 to 60 to 80%.
Great.
In the charging stations going in where the new police station's going, or the old police station?
Police station is not going anywhere. Police station is staying put. Police station is getting renovated and there's going to be an addition put on it, but the police station is not moving. Police station is staying put.
Okay. It's hard to keep up.
How about the stations at, I'm pointing at it, at Depot Park right over there?
Yes, so that's the one that the state actually will pay almost 80% of it. Okay. And then our energy revolving account. So there's really no cost to the town, but our energy revolving account will pay for the rest. And it's money we get from rebates and things that we keep separate. We'll pay for the 20%.
So when will we hear about those grants?
They said it's on a rolling admission, kind of like, you know, first come, first serve. Maybe by the end of this really month, because they're looking to make it really quick. And the depot, I mean, the electrical work already started, so it will be there. So we actually selected a different vendor than what we have for the existing ones. The existing ones are ChargePoint. This one most likely will be a different name. It's called Blink. Yep. And we just found they're easier to really, for us in case of the depot, is just the money collection. They do all the transaction, they do everything. And then as soon as we build $50 in revenue, they cut the check. So it could be at least once a month, but you have to have at least $50 in revenue, which we expect to have. And they'll just send us a check so we can pay for the electricity that we would pay for.
So this sounds like something that would be a really good article to put in the newspaper to publicize it.
Especially when it's about to open, that would be a really good time to. Two things that we're taking advantage of state funds that are available, because everybody likes to hear their tax dollars coming back to their community, but also play up once it's there so people can start using the depot one, as well as people who might have been experiencing the other ones being full, seeing that they're going in.
Yeah.
Maybe a series of articles.
I do think that there's, especially as we encourage the build out of the infrastructure for EVs. And I know, there might be some opportunities on the planning board for them to make sure that developers are including them and redevelopment, et cetera. And then we're putting in infrastructure on municipal properties. I think it really is important for people to know this exists, because when I even had somebody come up to me on election day who wanted to know my position about EV charging stations, I'm like, well, we have some and we're getting more. I think he didn't really know, and most people, you can't blame them, like they're not coming to energy and sustainability. Not that we are the best show in town, but they may not know, like, who is this for and how do I use it and is it okay and what's available and if this one's full, where's there another one? And so, yeah, I think that probably makes sense.
And just really not a clarification, but just to credit Revise Energy, because they're paying for the difference for the depot location. So part of it is the grant, and part of it is really Revise Energy. So there's not a penny coming out of the town or the energy account.
And if we want to write a series of articles, maybe someone can do a ride along in the new police EV.
I'll drive it.
I think that we should get one of those like middle school students who's doing Bedford TV to like shoot a series. Like that would be super fun, actually. And I'm not even kidding. I think that there probably is some middle schooler who would think that was a fun project.
Yeah,
just don't be the person that gets arrested on that day. You'll be immortalized on Bedford TV.
Does anyone want to start writing an article now, or do you want to wait till next month? Hopefully the grants will be approved and we can highlight that. Do we have any volunteers to take that charge though when it's time?
I can start talking to Sierra about the details of, how many and where and the company and, how that's all going to work.
Okay, great. Thank you.
I don't think we should write the article until we get the grants, but
Right.
Laying the groundwork.
Yeah. Awesome.
Any composting updates?
Composting. So we are up to 242 participants in Black Earth. I know that other company has a few people who participate. I should probably put that on my call list to call them. It's easy for me to check Black Earth because I'm a member. The sad news is this, even though the cost is now down to $69.99 for 6 months, it will take us 2.25 years to get up to the next level to have a discount of $300. So maybe once we're all back in school and we start the food waste program, that will have a benefit for getting more kids to talk their parents about composting at home. I'm surprised more people didn't sign up during COVID, actually. But I don't know, I'm open to ideas of what to do. Just Margaret's our advocate.
Yes, I am.
what would really be the best thing to do is to have the town be able to do it. Somehow figure out how we make this happen Mm-hmm. I know it needs to be cost effective, but.
Yeah, no, we definitely, I mean, I will just say, I'm not sure where the composting program lies in the priorities of the DPW at the moment. And that's just an honest assessment that I don't know what's competing for the time within the DPW, but I do know that it is something that continues to be actively
supported.
And we at our budget discussion this year, when the select board was looking at the budgets, our budgets, which include the DPW budgets, and we looked at the increase in not only the cost of the hauling contract, but the cost of the tipping fees, which have gone up substantially. I brought up the composting. We talked about the financial opportunity that presents, because with the tipping fees becoming more and more expensive, then the value proposition of composting looks better and better. So it is still on the plate. I don't know where on the plate. I will continue to talk about it. I feel confident that as the opportunity becomes clearer, that the town manager and the DPW director are fully aware of our interest, energy and sustainability's interest in moving forward with something in a way that makes sense financially and environmentally. I'm positive that they have heard that message loud and clear. So again, I know that's not a very satisfying answer because I can't give you a timeline of when. And I'm happy to make inquiries and see if there's been more progress on that since the last time that we talked about that. But that's all I know right now.
So the only other thing I might like to add to that is that whenever I've talked about composting to people, what I always hear is it's sort of for people who can afford to do this, right? Is that it's sort of in it, and that just kind of grinds at me that it's sort of an elitist activity that people think we participate in by composting. And that we do have a nice affordable housing contingent in town that probably could use something to do, even if it's not on an individual basis, but as in a community basis where our affordable housing is located. I just want to put a plug in for that to somehow, it's not just the affordability, it's that it's being responsible to doing the right thing for everybody. And I said it on TV, I guess.
So Chris, I would add on the glass half full front, I do think there are a fair number of people that do compost in their backyards or side yards or wherever.
Yes.
And even in the wintertime, I know when we used to do it before we got the black earth, we might wait a little longer or stick it on the deck and let it freeze, but eventually it got into the compost bin. Now, granted, there are certain things that black earth takes that the backyard composting doesn't, but
that's true.
For people that don't eat a lot of meat and don't have a lot of bones, we're composting almost the exact same amount, both directions. So I think there are far more people in 242 plus the few others you mentioned who are doing active composting.
Yeah, I mean, I fall into that same category, as you know, and I'm, you know, going on my, you know, practically my 30th year of being a composter. And I would say, you know, I'll teach anyone, anywhere, anytime how to start their own compost bin. I know the DPW still offers, to my knowledge, still has discounted compost bins that residents can purchase. I do believe that there are backyard composters. I think it's a legitimate question for, you know, multi-dwelling household or families, you know, is there opportunity, because you can't do it individually, you have to do it collectively. you know, if there were residents who were advocating to their management, could they access it, things like that, like breaking down the barriers. I agree, Chris, this is a great idea. I think it's probably like a multi-pronged thing. Some of it is cost, some of it is just unfamiliarity, people, hard for people to change habits. I mean, like I cannot physically put an orange peel in the trash, like it's so against my normal routine. And seriously, if someone comes to my house, they stick the orange peel in my trash, I pick it out and I put it in the compost.
I do too.
But through all of it. But many people who have spent their whole lives not composting need some change, whatever the change of mindset is, right? And I know in communities that mandate it, like when I was in Europe, I was in Italy a couple summers ago, and they were extremely prescribed recycling, different types of recycling, different bins. You had to put the right thing in the right bin. They would give you a ticket if you put the wrong thing in the wrong bin. And so like you trained yourself, even while I was there, I had to be even more sort of conscious of what I put in which bin. Even though I'm a composter by nature, right? There was even different levels of things that got put in different bins. So sometimes it is that kind of collective commitment to something that brings everybody along. You're just like, okay, this is what you do, and this is what you do. And you don't have to make a personal decision about it. And I am hopeful that we will get there. In the meantime, I think energy and sustainability should raise the awareness that people who want to home compost, if Black Earth isn't affordable to you, there's home composting options. And composting is not scary and it's not dangerous, and you can learn how to do it if you want to. But I think it's a hearts and minds issue at this point until it becomes a systemic thing.
I think it'll happen. It's just when. Thank you, Margot.
Well, and perhaps that would be a good citizen piece for this month. For this upcoming month, just kind of the home composting 101. That's something I'd be happy to work on. If that
I'll work good. On that with you.
Okay, thank you. Any town building updates?
No, just like I said, we're testing that energy manager dashboard. And like Margot said, we have a couple of capital projects. Hopefully they'll get the support needed, the police and the library. Other than that, we're waiting for the kids to come back to schools and we're doing more ventilation.
So, April 5th, right?
All good. Yeah, for Davis and Lane, April 5th. And JGMS and the high school, April 25, I believe, right after school
vacation.
Yeah.
That's great.
And maybe you'll be able to really open windows.
They're opening them now.
Outside, yeah. But you won't.
Warm enough now, they're opening them.
Yeah,
but you won't be losing air. You'll get that nice fresh breeze.
I don't have a home energy assessment update this month. I don't know if anyone else had any news on that front. Okay. Then the ESD webpage review, I know we touched on that a little bit earlier. There was just one typo that I had noticed on the page. It's in the blue box on the left-hand corner. It says energy efficient appliances, just to remove the comma, it says appliances with an
apostrophe. Yep.
Apostrophe. Thank you. And then the period as well. The end.
Yep. And I did update the slide we had in there to put the John O'Rourke language at the bottom. So we are now compliant with the new rules.
And would it be possible to share the presentation that Fred Cunningham provided on the list?
Yeah, we can put that. So you already sent that in the mail, right?
So I sent the one that he then referred to after his official presentation, but I can request the his other presentation too, and we could put both up.
Okay.
I actually think that the one that you sent us in advance is, if we wanted people to see one of them,
that's the one.
I mean, his presentation was very helpful tonight, but I think in terms of the more information rich one, the one that you circulated by email is the one that we should have on our website.
Yes.
Okay, that sounds good. Yeah, we'll stick to that
one. I agree.
Okay. Anything else for the website? We have the, we
need to approve. I just want to tell Susie she's done a great job putting stuff out there, getting it put out. Thank you very much. It looks like if we kept track of all of our action items, we should be having a party. We should be celebrating.
Yeah, it does.
Always.
So the February meeting minutes, any changes to those or comments? I just had two small typos. One was on page 3. The little, the couple sentences right above section 2. It says select board will likely ask about how any recommendations. I think we just want to omit the 4 recommendations match Bedford's net zero plan goals. And then on page 6 under new business, just another typo, just want to make that Mr.
Oh, yeah. I didn't know I was a mountain.
But if there are no other changes, could we get a motion to approve the February 24, 2021 meeting minutes as amended?
So moved. I move that we approve the meetings from February 24, 2021.
Seconded.
As amended.
Okay. Roll call vote starting with Susie.
Aye.
Bob.
Aye.
Dan.
Aye.
Margot.
Aye.
Chris.
Aye.
And aye. Meeting minutes approved 600.
So Emily, one quick question. When I print them out, I get these weird page numbers. Mine, every page is 4 of 6. Is that just the way Word is treating it, or did other people get that same thing?
That's a good question. I've gotten it at times. It's correct on the version I have in front of me tonight, yeah. But it's, okay.
So maybe
it depends for me at least.
Okay.
And finally, is there any new business? Okay, well, I think we covered a lot tonight. And
awesome.
We have a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Okay.
Seconded.
Second.
And we'll do a roll call vote starting with Susie.
Aye.
Bob.
Aye.
Dan.
Aye.
Margot.
Aye.
Christine.
Aye.
And I, meeting adjourned, and I will send around a doodle so we can schedule our April meeting.
Great. And who will I see? Is there no one coming to finance committee? Should I?
I'm going to try to be there.
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent.
I'll try to be there. Yeah.
I appreciate that. All right. I'll see you all tomorrow night then.
Okay. Bye.
Thank you, everybody. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.